Es wird gesprochen von einem digitalen Delirium. Und der Mann, der jetzt hier gerade schon seinen Laptop vorbereitet, ist Nishant Shah. Er arbeitet an der Bangalore Center for Internet and Society, hat auch dort seine Doktorarbeit geschrieben. Und ich bin sehr, sehr, sehr gespannt, weil der Vortrag, der wird jetzt, glaube ich, etwas länger, nicht eine halbe, sondern eine Dreiviertelstunde bis eine Stunde. Danach wird es noch die Möglichkeiten, selbstverständlich geben, Fragen zu stellen. Und geht's? Und deswegen Applaus, Nishant Shah, bitteschön.
Hi, thank you. I must begin by telling you that I speak 6 Indian languages, 3 South Asian languages, a little bit of Chinese, but no German. So you'll have to bear with me while I speak in English. I have also been accused of becoming subsonic when I'm speaking, and I'm audible only to bats. So when I do that, somebody please stop me and ask me to give you a human readable version of what I'm saying. I'm here to present something called Digital Natives with a Cause. There is a question mark at the end of it, which I thought was very important, but got eliminated in the program somewhere. So I want to emphasize that there is a question mark in the title somewhere. My name is Nishant. I'm going to be examining the new political nature of interventions and activism with technology, specifically looking at young people in emerging information societies. I work for this organization called Center for Internet and Society in Bangalore, India. I want to begin with this bizarre question about what is a digital native. I've been teaching this course, we've been doing this research work for about last 2.5 years now, and every time I encounter an audience, we presume that we know what a digital native is. I just want to begin with a show of hands saying how many people have heard of the phrase digital natives? Oh wow, that's a lot. When I encounter digital natives and ask them if they've heard about it, they generally give me a blank look. It's a very contentious term because we're not really always very sure what it is that a digital native is. There are lots of examples that we have of what a digital native does, and I'm sure you'll be able to give me many of them. Throughout yesterday and perhaps in the morning, we've heard about how digital natives blog. Actually, they don't. Apparently, blogging is now 20th century and they no longer do it. Digital natives use Twitter, digital natives are revolutionaries and so on and so forth. But what we really wanted to explore was the possibility of looking at politics beyond the traditional and understood domain of political. Let's begin with this peculiar form of techno-social identity of the digital native, which is always caught in what we call a binary fallacy. At the one hand, the digital native is a global citizen. He or she connects with millions of people on the internet who are doing exactly the same things in the same kind of manners. On the other hand, the digital native is always circumscribed by geography, that they are within their particular contexts, within their societies, within their cultures, within their nation states, and that there is this double bind which is operating on the definition and understanding of what a digital native is. To make my point perhaps very clear, on the one hand, you're supposed to be hyper-territorial. You're not supposed to be bound by your skin color, your language, your nationality, your race, your religion, and so on. At the same time, the only credibility that you have when you posit yourself online to do any kind of intervention is indeed the fact that you are belonging to a particular nationality, that you have a certain language that you speak, that you are an insider who's located within a body and a geography. So it's not as if a digital native falls in an either-or category, but that they are bound together within this double binary, which perhaps is interesting to follow. Similar kinds of things which have cropped up actually when we were talking about digital natives is this double bind of expectation and anxiety. I'm going to begin by working with a very, very cursory definition of what a digital native is. Mark Prensky, who possibly, well, at least he claims that he coined the term digital native, says that anybody who was born after the 1980s is a digital native, which means that the oldest digital native has now turned about 30. And the youngest one has not yet been born because he or she is still a fetus who is now being digitized through sonograms, through mammograms, and what have you, right? There is a certain way by which the digital natives, who are largely a younger part of our population, bound within the notions of expectations and anxieties. And what I want to do for you is briefly first list out the most common expectations and anxieties which are bound, which surround the discourse around digital natives. Let's begin with the fact that this is the dumbest generation. Is there anybody in the audience who agrees with that formulation? Thank you. Is there anybody who has heard about this before? This particular lament that young people are no longer thinking, that we seem to be producing a lot of people who are just consuming and doing nothing else. All right. Mark Bolin actually wrote a book called The Dumbest Generation in 2007, where he talks about how we are now producing a generation that has forgotten how to think. That all we can do is hyperlink, all we can do is source, all we can do is reflect each other's thoughts and opinions without really analyzing about them, right? This is the number one anxiety that perhaps grounds everybody, including professors in academia, researchers, political governors, and so on and so forth. The second anxiety is about how the digital natives are addicted and dangerous. This is not really surprising. Within the language of internet usage, there has always been the presumption that there is something addictive and drug-like about the internet. We never heard about a user of cinema, have we? We call them cinemophiles, right? We never heard about users of print technologies, we call them bibliophiles. But when we talk about people who use technology, they are addicted to digital technologies, they are users of internet technologies. That there is a certain way by which anybody who uses excessively these digital forms is immediately looked upon as addicted and dangerous. A formulation that allows now, in a very, very scary way, a country like China to start internet rehabilitation centers for young people. So that in 2009, there was a very peculiar case in China where a youngster played, I think, World of Warcraft, an MMORPG which is quite famous, for about 36 hours at a stretch, and then climbed up a tall building and jumped down because he thought that he could fly. Following that, China started the internet rehabilitation centers where you are now unplugged, disconnected, and physically punished in order to cure you of the usage of internet technologies, right? We're also talking about how digital natives then are also dangerous. This is not really very new. About 6 or 7 years of discourse about school shootouts from around the world, where apparently young people who played video games had access to then arms and ammunition and then went to their schools and shot down their colleagues and teachers. So there is a certain formulation of the digital native as addicted and dangerous, which is also quite in vogue. The third anxiety I want to chart is really simply the copy-paste cultures. Anybody who's taught or anybody who has been a student in the last 10 years has been looked upon with suspicion, with an eyebrow raised and saying, where did you get this particular information from? And there is of course the emergence of Wikipedia, and now we have two kinds of warring factions. There are people who swear by the Wikipedia, and there are people who swear at it. The people who swear at it are the people who constantly complain that nobody seems to do any original writing anymore. That we live in a world where digital copies are so easy to make and there is no distinction between the original and the duplicate, that young people are constantly reproducing rather than producing something themselves. The next anxiety is about the rise of screenagers. Have people seen the movie Wall-E? Wall-E? Yeah? A lot of you. The apocalyptic picture that Wall-E has, where there are people who sit on couches and who can interact with each other only through mobile interfaces or screens, is something that has always been a pet favorite for a lot of sociologists and anthropologists. That they say that we are no longer raising teenagers, but screenagers. People who are sitting in this audience who cannot look at me, but only either at the screen or their laptops or their iPods or what have you. That there is a certain anxiety about human relationships, human communication deteriorating, as if there is no need for human touch anymore, that all we do is eye touch and not touch, so to speak. So basically looking at that. And the last one perhaps is about the fact that digital natives seem to be devoted to self-gratification of an extraordinary order. That while they might be spending a lot of time on blogging, a fairly highly celebrated tool, at the end of the day, what they write on a blog is about what I had for breakfast in the morning, right? That there seems to be this whole syndrome of my bubble, my space, that this is my digital space that I have created, and it will now cater only to my gratification, my expectation from life, certain notion of entertainment, information exchange, social networking, and so on. So these are the list of anxieties. And the last one, of course, is that the digital natives are a danger unto themselves. Because in 20 years, a large part of the population is going to no longer remain students or children, that they are going to flood universities, workforces, political organizations, and governments across the world. And then what are we going to do with these young people who apparently have grown up with these kinds of disorders raised by the internet? So these are the kind of anxieties which have been very popular in this particular field of digital natives, talking about youth and technology. From there, then, I want to move on to a slightly happier picture, perhaps, but also problematic in terms of expectations which surround digital natives. One of the first things that comes up is the whole notion of freedom. The internet was supposed to set us free. The internet was supposed to cure every evil there was in the world. The internet, like every other technology, was supposed to make universal brotherhood and world peace more than just a beauty pageant quotient, right? But it's not really worked out that way. And that there is a certain celebration of the free that remains very confused. Well, there is free as in beer, saying that you do something for me for free and I will do it for you and I will give you beer for it. There is, of course, free as in free in terms that we are indeed now free and liberated from certain shackles of, I don't know, who are the common demons? Let's say Microsoft as in neoliberal economy, let's say Google as in the new big bad wolf, and so on and so forth. That there is certain celebration of freedom which gets very easily touted when talking about young people and the expectations about them. The second and the more scary part, perhaps, is that of tolerance. If anybody has been part of discussion forums online, or if you looked at different ways in which people interact, you basically end up by saying that we will coexist in tolerance. Not in acceptance, but in tolerance. This is a new political correctness which has emerged online. That you are wrong and I'm wrong, and so we will both be wrong together. Instead of setting up a negotiation or a dialogue, what we will eventually have is this compromise of tolerance, where I will tolerate that you are an idiot and you will tolerate that I'm stupid, and that we will both interact with each other at that level, right? So there is that particular problem which comes in. The next one is about diversity and its discontent. How many brown people in the audience today? Really? How many Asians today? None? Yes, Asians, people from Asia? Just one? Well, that's diverse, surely. We should be celebrated now. You had an Asian speaker coming and speaking to you, right? I'm just being facetious. But the thing is that there is this certain exoticization of emerging information societies online. That if you are able to reproduce yourself as outside of the mainstream, as outside of somebody who does not exactly belong to you, as somebody who is just different enough to talk to you in your language, then that person becomes accepted in that particular community. So that if suddenly right now main agar hindi mein baat karne lagun aur aapse kahunga ki main to isi bhasha mein baat karunga, then there is a sudden standstill. Right? There is only diversity in as much as people are like us while they are still different. And that this kind of diversity needs to be questioned more instead of just the celebration that happens when we are talking about digital natives of a certain kind. The next thing is about collaboration and participation. I think a lot has been said about collaboration. I think a lot of it is interesting in terms of what it does in challenging the intellectual property rights regimes that we have established and what a lot of the corporate conglomerates are trying to kind of fight right now. That there is a certain value perhaps to collaborative knowledge and the wisdom of the crowd, but I don't know anybody who has taught undergraduate students for more than 3 years can only despair at the wisdom of the crowds. So I'm not particularly sure how much value there is in it and whether it has to be taken at face value that everything that is crowdsourced is going to be important, is going to be the de facto and the more intelligent way of producing knowledge. I'm not particularly sure. We had an excellent presentation yesterday which talked about how the internet creates an illusion of participation and not really participation itself. And this is the kind of question which we are trying to deal with, and I'm going to give you perhaps 3 case studies eventually to try and draw a happier picture as a contrary to the bleakness that I'm drawing right now. So all of you who've taken out tissues and are crying about the future of the internet, just hold on for two more minutes. The next thing I want to just talk about is the overwhelming sense of engaged social transformation, which is pinned upon digital natives entirely. It's not a new phenomenon. With every new technology in the history of the world, there has always been a certain kind of expectation which is put upon the youth who's going to be the torchbearer of the technology and who's going to set out to cure the evils of the world. So that if we look at the history of revolutions in almost any civilization, we realize that young people have used different technologies to make social transformations available for their immediate contexts, right? So that's not new. What is new is this pressure to be also globally viable at every single time when you make an intervention. So that when you are making an intervention at a small scale level, you're not really making something significant. The internet has brought to the fore this seductive thing called the production of large numbers, where if you do not have 1 million followers, you are not an internet guru. Where if you do not have 10,000 people participating in your context, and it's not really, it's basically a failed project of some sort or the other. So we're trying to kind of look at these kinds of pressures which come upon the digital natives, and realize that in all of these things, there is one thing which is missing, which is that we still don't have a definition of what a digital native is. That when I set out with the question of saying, what is a digital native, I'm told that a digital native is a digital native is a digital native. That what you have is a list and a litany of things that people do, what is expected of them, what are the anxieties which we have around them, but nobody really tries and figures out what is a digital native. And this is the point of entry for the work that we are doing right now. And it is from this particular context that I want to give out about 3 case studies which look at pranksters, jesters, and clowns. These are the 3 forms of which digital natives which are most familiar to us. That digital natives are pranksters, they do vandalism, they do piracy, they go do hacks, they crack into government systems, they play pranks and jokes at a much, much larger level. The second about how digital natives are jesters, that they perform and then they entertain, that they make podcasts about personal things in their life. Apparently the Germans have been doing it since a long time with public penises, as was told us yesterday. But that there is a certain way by which this is a technology which strips you down, which allows to do virtual performances of certain kinds and makes you into jesters and clowns at the end of the day. There are 3 stories around which of them which I want to see as new political emerging. So from the public penises yesterday to the Pink Chaddi campaign, and this is a story from India, this phenomenon actually got a lot of coverage sometime last year. I just wanted to know if anybody's found this particular campaign online or in the news or in media. Has anybody heard of the Pink Chaddi campaign? All right, the Chaddi is the Hindi word you have? Okay, good. One soulmate. The Chaddi is the Hindi word for panties in India. And the Pink Chaddi campaign was one of the most successful digital natives campaign that started last year. It does not really talk about politics in the way we have understood politics in the traditional sense. And this is the story. In early 2009, there was a bunch of right-wing activists who decided to beat up women who go to pubs or bars, or who smoke, or who wear Western clothes, because these women are an aberration on our Indian culture. So of course they decided that the Indian way of doing things, and please realize that I'm being extremely sarcastic, that they realized that the Indian way of doing things was to beat up these women in public and to make sure that they wear only attire which is amenable to these hooligans, who are the right-wing government party in the state called Karnataka, the city of Bangalore where I live in. The initial reaction, of course, from the press, from the media, was one of shock and horror, but there was not really much done about it. After the 5 days of media coverage, the news was cold, there was nothing interesting happening there. The next big thing was that these hooligans also decided that if they found couples dating on Valentine's Day, they're going to go get them forcibly married. Right? That they will go around with a priest, and if they find a boy and a girl dating, it's always only a boy and a girl, it's never a boy and a boy or a girl and a girl. But if they find a boy and a girl on a date, then they will get them married off. So these are the kinds of strange ways by which the right-wing government was trying to impose a certain right-wing fundamentalist, okay, expletives are going to come out, a bad form of politics in the city. A lot of women's groups tried to mobilize awareness around it and kind of failed when they're trying to do traditional sense of politics. There was a lot of, as I said, media discourse which did not work. The campaign which was successful was run by a young girl called Nisha Susan, who started a Facebook campaign called the Pink Chaddi campaign. On that campaign, she created a Facebook page and she invited people to buy pink underwear and send it to the political leaders who were supporting these right-wing fundamentalist movements. It became a wildfire. In about a week, there were 200,000 pink panties which were mailed. Some of them were also soiled. Some of them also contained, well, bodily excretions, let's say, which were mailed to the political people, to the hooligans, to their you know, fundamental party in order to make a point about it. What was extraordinary about it was that the entire campaign was envisioned by one person and was run only on Facebook. That in a week, she was able to harvest the entire system of networking, of social networks, of inheriting people's groups and communities, and mobilize a huge community of young people in India who were able to then make a significant intervention at a political level, which was not possible before this. That in a case scenario where traditional politics of women's movements, of left-wing movements, failed to make an intervention, with this very, very playful, irreverent sort of an intervention, the digital natives were able to achieve something that was fantastic. For India especially, but also for South Asia perhaps, this was the first indication of how we need to start rethinking our notion of political engagement. That while there are international stories about, let's say, the questionable Twitter revolution in Iran, you really need to focus on what are the ways in which new kinds of political formulations, new kinds of political engagements are being made possible because of young people's presence and use of digital technologies. That what Nisha and her gang did was no longer politics in the way that we have understood in Asia. That it was no longer a campaign in terms of a street demonstration. It was not a petition written to the governor. It was not a call for cry. It was a head-on tackling of a problem which was in their immediate environment, and it was playing with it fun with joy, and was able to mobilize an extraordinary number of people who are otherwise painted as apathetic to the political situation in the country. Right? So this is the first story I wanted to give you of how, through the question of, well, you know, pranks, through jestfulness, through clowning around, people were able to do some very interesting things. As an offshoot of the Pink Chaddi campaign, we also had some very interesting campaigns. One of them was called Pub Bharo. Pub as in the pub, Bharo is the Hindi word for fill it up. So that we also had a week of thousands upon thousands of women who came to the pubs and occupied them to make a point that this is their public space and they are going to claim it in any way as possible, right? So it didn't require a huge NGO or a development sector agency to mobilize the campaign, but it happened entirely online. The second story is from China, where we have a story about 10 legendary obscene beasts in China. Here is a brief context. In 2008, I think, Wikipedia was banned in China for reasons whatever, everybody's talked about it. The ban of Wikipedia was a boon to this particular ISP, the internet service provider called Baidu. Baidu is the largest internet service provider in China, in mainland China, and they run a Wikipedia-like site, which is called Baidupedia. The Baidupedia has been allowed in China because it self-censors itself. It is completely in compliance with China's censorship policies about what can be written online, what can be articulated, and what is the kind of information which will be available in that particular language. Interestingly, Baidupedia also has a brilliant plagiarism mechanism where it takes up Wikipedia articles, filters them down through the censorship policy, and then puts it up on the Baidupedia itself. On Baidupedia, which was then supposed to be the safe site, there was a case of vandalism. But this wasn't vandalism in the traditional sense. In terms that it wasn't harming somebody, there was no libel, there was no slander. But a group of activists came together to create this one particular page, which is called the 10 Legendary Obscene Beasts of China. What they did was that they created an extraordinarily profane language to talk of the politics and of the government in a certain way. So that, are people familiar with Mandarin as a language? Okay, can I just quickly run through a small course in linguistics in terms that simplified Mandarin has four tones, so that each word has four tones, and depending upon the tone, the meaning of the word changes, right? So if I say ma, 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 there are four different meanings to that, right? So what these people did was that they took up the phonetic possibility and created these characters which basically spelled out extremely profane names. One of the first and the most popular one was called Chao Ni Ma, which if you take the way it is written, it is actually a mud grass horse. But if you speak out correctly the way it's supposed to be, which is Chao Ni Ma, it means doing inappropriate things to your mother. All right? So they started making basically these pages upon pages of these obscene creatures, which then kind of go on and take up an allegorical relationship with the state government censorship, with the whole notion of Chinese harmony, which allows them to create censorship online and so on. And it went on to become one of the most popular spaces and placeholders of resistance in Chinese blogosphere right now. So that last year when I was in Shanghai for about 9 months, during the Chinese New Year, the best-selling stuffed toy was a Chao Ni Ma. So that you had 6 and 7 year olds who were buying a Chao Ni Ma doll, which is a legendary mud grass horse doll, but then they were actually using it as a form of protest against the kind of impositions and dictatorial regimes that the Chinese government puts onto their internet usage. Right? So if you start looking at objects like the Chao Ni Ma, which is less, let's say, political than the Pink Chaddi campaign, which is so obviously in the domain of intervention making, you start realizing that there is more to these pranks than just prankstership. That the conditions of technology allows these people to become potentially politically engaged in ways in which traditional politics does not really always understand it. That I can't imagine any civil society organization or a political organization trying to make an intervention by creating a vandalism page within a particular space. That it is the embedment of these digital natives in these circumstances that kind of allows them to play in a new form with digital technologies, with cultural production, and with different notions of political intervention. Now, I speak quite a lot, and I speak very fast, so I'm going to give you a brief respite. What I want to show you as a shameless plug is an intervention that some of my friends in Thailand made in 2006. I was privileged to be a part of the project, where in Thailand, in Bangkok, to fight against questions of global warming, 200 school kids came to the streets of Bangkok to beg. Right? And this is a dramatization of that, and I'll talk a little bit about more after that.
Nothing breaks my heart as much as emptiness. So much I need to say, I can't confide. Something in the air, it says that you're not there. So hard to get it through, 'cause you don't care. No, I'm begging you please, it's not out of reach. A better new way, make it worthwhile. So give me your heart and open your eyes. I know that you can. Begging you, please. Begging you, please. So why don't you lend a helping hand?
Please just do it.
Leave yourself spread across the land.
Let it all
and make it shine, shine. Begging you, please. Thank you.
Thank you. I think it's an extraordinary campaign because global warming is a real issue for Thailand. It's a small island, it's sinking almost every day. You can see it sinking. The government has spent more than $1 billion now on trying to promote awareness around global warming campaigns, not too much effect. Does anybody want to guess how much money was spent in making this particular campaign viable? About $30. Because we had to buy some cheap phones to do the shooting, which is why the resolution isn't really very good. But the thing is that the group of people who started this campaign, the oldest person was 16 years old. That they came together to mobilize their own people, which was people in schools, young school children and so on, to come to the streets of Bangkok on every Sunday to beg for awareness around global warming. The campaign has now been taken up by the government of Thailand as this national campaign, so that it invites now everybody who comes to Bangkok to come begging on the streets. Since the campaign, Thailand has reduced its carbon footprint by 23% in 3 years. Yeah? So I'm just trying to give you an idea of how there are new ways of political engagement. That there is a certain thing about collaboration and mobilization which is not restricted to large numbers of people coming on the streets for demonstrations, for campaigns, for rallies and so on. But that there is a very strategic use of technology which enables very young people to deal with immediate crises in their environment in very, very interesting ways. That it sometimes looks like games and, you know, it looks like flash mobs and it looks like different forms of entertainment. It looks like they are embedded in a system where they seem to be only producing or doing things for fun and games, but that there is a certain political potential which is embedded in these. And the kind of work that we're doing is trying to raise awareness among the young people about the use of their technology and the ways in which they can indeed, if they want to, change the world. I want to leave you with one last story. This is more perhaps international, but and probably more popular in Europe. Are you familiar with Matt Harding? Yeah? Okay, does anybody want to ask me who the hell is Matt Harding? All right, let's do a group exercise. On the count of three, I want you to scream, who the hell is Matt Harding, right? Okay, one, two, three. Right, it's the right question? No, it's the wrong question. The question to ask is, where the hell is Matt Harding? Matt Harding is a nomadic dancer who goes from one city to another to dance with people. He was 26 when he started his first campaign. He was based out of the US, and his job was to make violent video games about the end of the world. He decided that he's fed up of his job, and that what he really wants to do is do something about questions of universal brotherhood, about opening up boundaries and culture, of society, of politics, and so on. And so he decided to do away with his job and go dancing across the world. In the first 3 years of his life, of his dancing life, Matt Harding produced 3 videos which became some of the most popular videos ever seen on YouTube. And the videos were always called, Where the Hell is Matt Harding? He became extremely popular, and so now he's now the brand ambassador for many things. I'm also going to show you one of his videos right now. But Matt Harding basically has become an icon for young people who want to talk about questions of peace, questions of cultural exchange, and questions of harmony without sounding too cheesy and Miss Beauty pageant-ish about it. So one last video, one last explanation about it, and then we can go into question answers. This is the third video from the series, Where the Hell is Matt? And it starts in India.
That way, okay?
Yeah.
Hold the stick.
Hold the stick.
Thank you.
Right, so that's where the hell is Matt Harding. You can go to his website because he now maintains a schedule of where he's going to go and dance next. If he comes to Berlin, maybe you can go and join him in the dancing. I think Matt Harding was an interesting phenomenon because it was a single person who used his popularity on YouTube to leverage a certain dialogue around questions of cultural brotherhood, about universal peace, and so on. This video is now on NASA's time capsule. Are people aware of the fact that NASA has prepared a time capsule? Well, you know, tomorrow if a meteorite comes and eliminates the human civilization, then there must be some traces of things which tell the aliens who are going to come and eventually look at it that we existed. And so NASA has created a time capsule of some of the happiest moments in human civilization. And this particular video is now on the time capsule, and it is labeled Happy People on Planet Earth Dancing to Music. Right? So Matt Harding is an incredible phenomenon. While he's now also started Matt Harding dance groups, where people within a local community in a context come together on a regular basis to just come and dance stupidly. That there is a certain way by which dancing, playfulness, just coming together to do silly things, which might not always have a meaning, have started becoming an extremely strong political tool. That the ways in which people have collaborated over the Matt Harding, where he goes there and people dance with him, Matt Harding has, I think, now danced in more than 80 cities with more than 85,000 people, and he's still counting. Right? Just wanted to draw the attention to the fact that what people like Matt Harding are doing is not just clowning around. It's not just about dancing and fun, but it has in it the potential to mobilize people and to initiate dialogues, very, very strong political dialogues, which we otherwise fail to understand when we start looking at youth and technology interventions. That there is a way by which unchanging understanding of politics, traditional understandings of intervention are not able to comprehend what is happening with these viral ideologies and forms which are populating the internet. I just want you to then leave you with the question mark again about digital natives, causes and pauses. Three problems that we have encountered when looking at popular discourse around digital natives. We presume that the digital natives are going to make a difference, but we do not understand that the digital natives are also a part of a change. That there seems to be a certain dichotomy where they are supposed to change the world in the way we want them to change the world, and that anything that they do outside of it is immediately looked upon with suspicion. That there is a certain way by which a rhetoric or a discourse of a social construction of loss that surrounds digital natives. We have the very standard ways of talking about digital natives and the loss of innocence, about how our children are growing up much faster, that they are no longer really very innocent. Well, you know, now they play chat roulette. Okay, there's somebody there who plays it. I don't know what you do on it. But that there is a certain loss of innocence which is always a part of youth and technology. The second part is about something that perhaps has been the, I don't know, an underlining current throughout all the talks, which is about questions of privacy. That there is a loss of control in terms of what digital natives do with their lives, whether they are not aware of the kind of implications about what they do in the digital world and so on. There is also the question of loss of ethos, of ideology, of values and so on. And we want to kind of stop here and stop this narrative of loss and look upon it as a narrative of change. That what is happening is there is a certain transition that the digital revolutions are bringing in, and that this transition is not necessarily a bad one. That it is only when we look from the vantage points of the 1980s at the 2000s that we start thinking that there is something wrong with the world, that the young people are not really responding to the politics of the times very interestingly. But if you start looking at the ways in which they are trying to comprehend the notion of politics, they are trying to look at for example, shifting the realm of the politics from political to the cultural, where they are engaging in certain kinds of cultural and information and entertainment industries and production in order to make a political point, that seems to be a new narrative of digital natives emerging. One which is less bleak than the one that I started with, one which has more hope in it, one where we can say that while everything might not be hunky-dory with the world, while things might never be always the way they are supposed to be, there is a growing generation who's re-articulating our problems and our politics by using the technologies that they are familiar with in extremely interesting ways. So I'm going to stop here and take questions if there are any. We produced a Digital Natives report, which is now available for a free download on this website, which is the organization where I work. This is also my email address if you do want to write to me or query on a conversation about the work that we do. Thank you very much.
Bishan Shah, gibt's Fragen? Dann wäre jetzt die Möglichkeit. Ja, einfach zum Mikrofon dort in dem. Ja, rennen muss man jetzt nicht, aber kann man gerne.
I would like to have a question to the audience here.
Sorry, I'm blinded.
Yes, who can answer the question, are you a digital native in this audience? So if you would ask us, who thinks here is digital native?
Who here thinks that they are a digital native? Quite a lot of us.
Very good. And this my question was, yesterday we heard two other words, digital resident and digital visitors.
Migrants. Okay, yeah, migrants.
And that's the point I wanted to ask you, because, I mean, if you ask me if I would be a digital native, I would say no. But if I say I'm a digital resident, that's something else. What do you think about those?
One of the things that we are trying to say is that we don't want to go into hair splitting of categories which says digital natives, digital settlers, digital migrants, digital residents. It doesn't make a difference. At the end of the day, it is not about how long you have been using technology, but how familiar and comfortable you are with technology. My 63-year-old grandmother blogs in Gujarati, which is a vernacular language in Gujarat. She has an iPod, she carries a phone around, she has a photo blog, she is a digital native as far as I am concerned. That it is not about age, and that it is not about a certain kind of demography that marketing companies have developed for you, which says that people between the age group of 18 and 25 are going to be digital natives because they are the ones who are going to consume some of the most fancy electronic gadgets. No. What you really need to look upon is not how digital natives are people who are power users of technology, but digital natives are people whose lives have been significantly transformed because of the presence of technologies. So that is a kind of large-scale argument that we are looking at. Because if we were to look at only people who are 24/7 connected, who are always on Facebook, who are tweeting, who are extremely politically aware, that would be possibly a 0.02% of the population in the world or something. Yeah? Within information societies, especially within emerging information societies, there is a huge amount of people who are restructuring their lives, their livelihoods, their notions of politics and collaboration because of the presence of digital technologies. And for us, and every single person, everybody who is significantly affected by technologies in different ways is a digital native. Because they are not natives in terms of born with technologies, but they are natives in terms that they have contextualized technologies for their own use and environment. Right? So that's, I would suggest that do away with those, thank you. I would suggest do away with those corporate publishing world mechanisms by which you want to segregate everybody into a demography and look at a much larger level, people who are connected. Somebody, I think Morzovi yesterday said about how the internet is a connecting machine. And no, I think Jeff Jarvis talked about it. I don't know if you attended his talk. The internet is a connecting machine. And talk about technology as a medium by which people are connected with each other and they form the digital natives universe for us. So there are stories about, in India, for example, about people who live in slums but are significantly affected by the information technologies, and those are also digital natives for us. Yeah? Okay. Are there any other questions?
Oh, eine können wir noch. Eine Frage noch. Okay.
Yes, one more.
I would like to question the economic value of digital natives. Who will pay for their activities, and how can they adapt to the networked information economy? What jobs can they have, and like how do you see their future in the economy?
Economics is perhaps one of the easier questions to answer when it comes to digital natives. Especially in the developing countries, the state governments are themselves investing an incredible amount of money in doing development infrastructure and providing access, right? So that in India, for example, we have a mission called Vision 2020, where by the year 2020, 80% of the Indian population will be connected via the internet and will be online. But that is a very simple answer. I think there is something much more intricate which is at work over here. which is to say that let's not think of technology as providing solutions and answers, and let's not presume that everybody needs equal access to technology. That access to technology is not just material in terms of clicking on an internet, it is also experiential, it is also at the level of imagination in some form or the other. That let communities and people decide what are the kinds of access that they need for themselves based on the crisis that they identify in their own context. So that if there is a group of people who needs access to technology in order to look at questions of livelihood, then let them approach those technologies from those particular angles rather than inviting a Microsoft into the country and creating a global access protocol for the entire nation, right? So I hope I'm trying to answer your question, which is to say that there is much more to economics than livelihood, that there is also questions of entitlement, of legacies, of culture, of heritage, of belonging, of nationality, and so on, which are a part of the digital native identity as well. That we do not want to simplify it into a basic question of saying, those who have access to the internet have better jobs. It's not always true. Right? So it's much better to perhaps start from the horrifying word grassroots, to look at what people want from their own communities and their own contexts, and then bottom up raise the infrastructure so that it makes sense in terms of what they're going to do with these technologies. So the examples I was showing you were about people who identified what they want to do with technology and how then different mechanisms of infrastructure development were put into place in order to do that at different times.
So das war's jetzt. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Michan Schaar.